he has been speaking in public for years. And he says that now every time he speaks in public, he is now more confident. He is more ready because he has already got in 10 different public speaking reps today. So the success that he is having with every rep makes him more confident.
Hello, Liam. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thanks, Marty. Great to be here. Looking forward to this discussion.
So am I. So am I. And for anybody listening to this that is not yet familiar with who you are and what you do, could you introduce yourself to us?
Absolutely. So I'm Liam Sandford. I am the author of Effortless Public Speaking. And I'm also an active content creator, mainly on X or Twitter, as it used to be called, and LinkedIn. So do run a lot of social audio forums and discussions with people about different creator, business, entrepreneur type topics. One of those in the past has been public speaking. And that's ultimately the topic of my first book, Effortless Public Speaking, which I'm sure we might dive deeper into today.
And how did you get started with public speaking? Why is that something that you're passionate about?
So about 10 years ago, I had a fear of public speaking. And I remember sitting in a university lecture theater and we were told we're going to be picking on people to speak today. And I sunk in my seat. My heart was thumping. My hands were sweating, all of the signs that, you know, people absolutely dread. But I wasn't asked to speak that day. And it was just the thought of having to talk in front of a class of maybe 30 people and worrying about maybe what they thought about me answering a question, what I was going to say. And I knew that I did not want that feeling again. And so I went on a little bit of a journey to figure out how can I get comfortable with this, because public speaking is everywhere. It's a conversation. It's ordering coffee or food at a restaurant. It's asking for directions. It's, you know, a job interview. It's going to a meeting at work. You can't get away from it. So I didn't want a situation where every time there is a potential chance of me speaking in public, I have that response, because in one way, it's embarrassing. In another way, it's super uncomfortable and it's overwhelming and you just want to leave the room. But that's not an acceptable response. So I had to make a series of changes and go on a journey to figure out, how can I get comfortable at this? Then once I'm comfortable at this, how can I get confident? And then once I'm confident, how can I actually get good at this? And so that was the path. And that has now gone from, you know, having a fear of public speaking to teaching and coaching others how to speak stress-free in public. And I think I'm able to now come from the standpoint of, I know what that feels like and I know how bad it can be. And there is a lot of unhelpful advice out there. And so being able to come from the standpoint of the person with a fear of public speaking, you know, it's, I think there's a real benefit in sharing my story, sharing my journey and the tools, tactics, and the actionable items that really helped me to get there. And that's ultimately what Effortless Public Speaking, my book, was about. Because if those things help me, they're bound to help one other person who also might be hurt, who also might have a fear of public speaking, who also might just be super uncomfortable speaking to a room of 5 people or 30 people or 3,000 people, whatever that might be. And it's always better to be ready than to be asked to do it and, you know, have those responses of the thumping heart and your palms sweating and those physiological responses that at that time just feel unhelpful.
I would say that's a very enticing introduction to what you do and what the book is about. And I'm sure at least some of our listeners are already Googling how they can find it. But but before we do get into that, I do want to ask you something that you mentioned. I found that very interesting, that there is a lot of unhelpful advice, or perhaps even maybe potentially harmful advice out there. What are some of these things that our listeners have probably heard before, but that is maybe not very good advice?
So there is honestly so much out there, and whether the advice is good or bad might depend on where you're at in the public speaking journey. If you have a fear of public speaking, you do not want to be told how long you need to pause for, or that you shouldn't be using filler words, or that you should, you know, be using storytelling techniques to connect your audience. That's all noise at that level, because all you need to focus on is, what am I going to say? That's it at that stage of having a fear of public speaking, because you need to get comfortable first. And while you're doing that, you know, you're trying to calm your mind and you're trying to actually deliver at the best of your ability and get the knowledge that you have over to your audience. That's where your focus should be. So the standpoint I come from is, a lot of the advanced techniques are unhelpful. And at the same time, you know, some generic things that are unhelpful: you shouldn't stand behind a podium because it puts a distance between you and your audience, and it is a physical barrier. So from a perspective of connecting with your audience, that's a really poor thing. There are some awful techniques that people say, like, you know, picture the audience naked, or you know, these, I don't know where that came from. It doesn't even merit a response. It's it's that bad. And so I think that there's just so much noise, and the thing that you need to do to get comfortable first as a speaker is to speak. Now, that in itself is uncomfortable.
Yes.
But it's a harsh reality. And like, I know I've got a book on public speaking, but reading about speaking isn't going to do it for you either. That might give you a pointer in the right direction, but reading about something is not taking action. Reading about something is just getting ready to get ready. And I think that's often lost, because it very much feels like, oh, I'm reading this book, I'm picking up this knowledge, and as a result, I'm getting better. But that's not the reality. Improvement comes from practice. And there is a lot of bad advice out there. And probably what one more to share with you is to just throw yourself in the deep end and do it. Now, again, that's unhelpful. So when you're coming from a stance of, I'm terrified to get up in front of people, you need to be in a comfortable environment. So you need to start building successful reps of speaking, or doing something else that you have a fear of, because that's where confidence comes from. And confidence is success remembered. So if you only have negative, or what you perceive as a failed speaking attempt, you will never gain the confidence. So find the most comfortable environment that you possibly can. Maybe that's at home via a video call to a friend or a family member. Maybe it's over coffee to a colleague, just talking about the book that you're reading, or the football at the weekend, like whatever that might be, whatever is comfortable to you, that's where you should start. Not by throwing yourself in the deep end, because that only creates negative experiences. And to go on a journey of getting good at public speaking, you have to intentionally build successful public speaking practice.
I very much like what you're talking about with just starting at the very, very basic level, like you said, friends or family, maybe a colleague, somebody that you are already talking to, so it's not a strange face, it's not somebody new that's going to be judging me and oh, what are you even talking about? But like you said, that comfortable environment. And how do you scale that up? So let's say I'm comfortable talking to friends and family, that's all okay. But then how do you what would you recommend as the next step?
So I think if we zoom out a little bit from what public speaking is, because I think this is a really helpful question actually to address. And public speaking we tend to see as standing on a stage, maybe in front of 100 or 1,000 people, and talking to them for an hour. That's what we see as public speaking. Now, that is a pressure cooker environment. You're not going to be good at that the first time you do it. You're just not, because you've not done it before and it's uncomfortable. But if we break public speaking down to its most basic form, it is just a conversation. And that conversation can be with one person, it can be with more than one person. And in the book, we talk about what we call the nano speech. Now, a nano speech is a quick open, body, and close. So you open with something engaging, which might be, "Hi, Marty, I've been reading this book." Then the body of that might be, "This is the main point from this book." And then the close will be, "What are you reading?" Now, then we come back to your question, how do you scale up from conversations through to delivering a presentation or to the stage? Now, that nano speech that lasts 10 seconds is a public speaking repetition. Now, you can extend that and extend that so that the nano speech becomes 5 minutes. When you get to 5 minutes, you're no longer closing out after the body of what you're saying. You're transitioning to the next point. So a presentation is a bunch of stacked nano speeches. So that this is how you make conversations relevant to delivering a presentation at work, or delivering a seminar on a stage in front of thousands of people, because you can get a nano speech in the most comfortable environments. And the best thing about it when public speaking is just a conversation is the other person doesn't know that you're practicing your public speaking. So there is zero pressure. Pressure is completely removed, and there is only room for success in that conversation. So, scaling up needs to happen from the conversations and across different environments and time spent speaking. But using the nano speech is the way to do that. So, if you are comfortable now speaking to friends and family at home, then maybe you want to change that to you're comfortable speaking to colleagues in a work setting about the work that you're doing rather than something socially. So you scale up in the time that you spend speaking, you scale up in the different environments from virtual to in person to with people you know to with people you don't know. And you scale on the topics that you are comfortable talking about. And I think this is where, you start small, you get comfortable first, then you scale up when you're comfortable, and then you become confident. And then with that confidence, you can just build on that and improve and improve and improve and start, getting to advanced techniques, and then you become competent. So I think it's that cycle of comfortability first, confidence second, competence third, rather than jumping straight to, "I want to be the best speaker in the world," because that's way off, and I'm not there, nobody else is there. Like if I asked you right now, Marty, describe to me what the perfect speaking performance looks like, you wouldn't be able to tell me, because a stand-up comedy routine is different from delivering a presentation to a board meeting, to a politician delivering a speech to to, you know, canvas votes, they're all different. So rather than trying to shoot for, I want to be the best speaker I can, try and get comfortable first, then confident, then competent.
That's a wonderful piece of advice. And I very much like that it's a horizontal scale, that it's not really, okay, just keep doing the same thing over and over again, but try something different. Try this environment and that environment, like you said, online and in person and different people, strangers, colleagues, friends. And I like how it just scales on almost the same level without, okay, now I need to do, like you said, an hour presentation in front of 1,000 people. Let's just do five minute presentations in front of all of these different people that I know or don't know, which is a really wonderful piece of advice. And like you said, I think that's where so many people get stuck, that, oh, I'm terrible at public speaking, like you said, because I can't talk to thousands of people. Not many people can. You are not alone in that. So very nice to feel that support, certainly.
Absolutely. And like, if you do have that feeling of there's no way I'm going out to speak in front of anybody, then it's helpful to know that studies show 75% of the population have a fear of public speaking. And so just by starting to get comfortable, you're moving into the top 25% of people already in public speaking. And I think that's a helpful piece. But the nano speech that we've just been talking about, it's so easy to use every day to build a daily speaking habit. And usually if we talk about daily habits, that's something that sounds, you know, like it might overwhelm your schedule, or you're going to have to stop doing other things in order to do it. But with the nano speech, you don't really have to change anything, just how you deliver your conversation. And not every conversation should be public speaking practice. But every time you open a discussion is an opportunity for it. And even, you know, when you introduce yourself to a new colleague at work, for example, it might be, hi, I'm Liam. I've been with this company for this long. Where did you work before you joined us? That's the very simple nano speech that they have no idea that's a public speaking rep. And, you know, that's success. But with the daily speaking habit, the amazing thing is, with people that I've coached, they have used it, whether they are at the start of that scale with a fear of public speaking, or they are competent at speaking and they have been doing it for years. So one of my close friends tested this out, and he decided, I'm gonna go and deliver 10 nano speeches every day. And he started asking people for directions in the street. He started asking people for restaurant recommendations and then going and trying out the restaurant. And if he bumped into them again, he would deliver another nano speech to them, either asking for another restaurant recommendation because the first one was so good, or, you know, talking about the food that they had. And I think the benefit of this is, you know, it's not just about public speaking in a professional environment. It's about the everyday interactions that you have. And you can have some truly meaningful interactions and really, you know, land messages with people and put smiles on people's faces just with the nano speech. And my friend Craig Mizowitz, who has been using that a 10 nano speech a day framework, he has been speaking in public for years. And he says that now every time he speaks in public, he is now more confident. He is more ready because he has already got in 10 different public speaking reps today. So the success that he is having with every rep makes him more confident. And that rusty feeling that maybe you feel every time that, you know, you have a 2-3 month break from speaking in public or delivering a presentation, that's gone. Because the last repetition was an hour ago when I asked for directions when I didn't know where I was going to get to this venue. So I think the nano speech really is the tool that you can use whether you are a beginner or whether you are more advanced and you've been doing it for years and still make improvements.
I would say that's a really wonderful way to look at it. Also, what you said with asking for directions or maybe restaurant recommendations, and I feel like even me myself included in that, I would say some time ago, it's this fear of speaking to another human being, where in reality, like you said, the likelihood of that other person being scared of talking to you is just as high. And it's incredible that we're so scared of, like you said, what other people think of us, and oh, will they even respond? Will they want to talk to me? Maybe they're going to be scared, but I'm sure a lot of people appreciate that. A lot of people appreciate that contact. And I got that myself a lot of times, that, oh, I'm so thankful that you started talking to me, because I wanted to talk to somebody, but I was too scared to start the conversation. But now I'm great. Now you know, everybody's comfortable and everybody's having a good time. So that's a really nice way of thinking about it.
Absolutely. You never know what opportunities might come from just going and delivering a nano speech, or, you know, if you are asking for restaurant recommendations, you might have the best meal of your life. And I think, you know, there are just so many positive outcomes. And that piece you mentioned, of, you know, the people you're approaching are probably more scared. They absolutely are. If you think about, you know, if someone approaches you, you're probably more scared than they are when they are approaching. And, you know, meeting that with, you know, being friendly, and I think it's a great piece to, you know, start building your network too. And this is another piece where, you know, public speaking is amazing, is to build your network and get comfortable, you know, building relationships with people that you don't know. You know, maybe you're starting a new job and you need to go and network across the business to understand how it works. Like, the nano applies, and it's social skills at the end of the day. And I think that is a underrated benefit of being good at public speaking. And I think another thing that really is important here is that you can do that if you're an introvert. And I am one of the biggest introverts that you could ever meet. And maybe it doesn't seem like it because I've done a lot of talking on this podcast so far. But usually I am the quietest person in a room. But when I need to, you know, share something valuable, the nano speech is how I can do that in an engaging way where I'm comfortable, because I've done it a million times before. And also, I am very clear and concise in what I'm saying. So there is no room for interpretation. The person on the other end knows the message that I'm giving them. And therefore, you know, it's way better than that person who tells you the point once, and then they'll continue to tell it three or four more times in different ways, and then you get a bit confused about what you've been told. So I think both from a social perspective and also from a public speaking perspective, from delivering a presentation or a speech, being an introvert is a superpower. And people don't talk about that. Maybe because it's uncomfortable at first, but that's the reality.
It's actually very interesting that you mentioned that, because the last episode, the last podcast that I did was with a woman who is also a very well self-proclaimed introvert, and we were talking about how beneficial it might actually be versus, oh, why are you so quiet? Mm. Why aren't you saying anything, versus what it genuinely can mean for you and the benefits of being an introvert. So I like that we're making a little bit of a full circle with with that. But beyond, like you said, the nano speech, and I would say that's an incredible tip and an incredible piece of advice. Do you have any other maybe little tips, again, pieces of advice, some recommendations, some, let's say, actionable steps or maybe actionable habits for anybody listening that they can implement into their daily routine?
I think the nano speech is the main one, but I think storytelling and starting to bring that into your everyday conversations is really powerful. And I think there's a quote that was originally from Carl Buna, which said, "People don't remember what you say, but they will remember how you made them feel." And storytelling is the way to make people feel. And so that's something incredibly powerful in delivering a presentation. Now, you might be thinking, if you're listening to this, I don't have any stories to tell. Now, you absolutely do. So I would say from the ground level, if you feel like you don't have any stories to tell, start steering into the senses. So people know what it's like to smell, to touch, to feel, to taste. People understand that. So, you know, if you walked to your friend's house and they bake cookies, and you just said that to someone else, like, great, like that's a piece of information they might not remember. But if you said to them, as I was walking down the road, the smell of sweet cinnamon was coming from the window and my mouth was watering and I couldn't wait to get to the front door because I knew that shortly I'd be tasting those cookies. That's different. And that is storytelling. So steer into the senses, because I think that that's really powerful. And in particular, when you're landing a message with an audience, that's something that can switch someone on to be right there in the story with you. And I think that the second piece is to tell stories from everyday moments. So when you think of storytelling, you know, it might be the things that come to mind are probably, you know, jumping out of a plane or something crazy that might be in the opening sequence of a James Bond movie. Or, you know, these types of moments that don't happen to regular people. But regular people are your audience, generally speaking. And you got to steer into that. So most people get up in the morning, they have their breakfast, they go to work, they spend the day in the office, they come home, they have dinner with their family, they go to bed, and that's the routine of most people. So steer into those moments, because the way to bring people along the story with you is to make them feel like they're there. So if you tell somebody, you know, a story about the commute to work and the traffic was awful, they're probably going to understand that because they experience that on a day-to-day basis. So from an audience perspective, they're like, oh, I get this person. Like, I completely get the experience they're telling me about. And I want to know how it relates to what they're saying. And then, you know, they remember that a while later because they resonated with you. They connected with you because you made them feel, God, how annoying is that moment where I'm stuck in traffic? You made them feel that. And so tell stories from everyday moments. And I think we do that generally anyway, when we're speaking with our friends and family, like we're updating them on things that are going on in our lives. Bring the nano speech framework into that. And within the body of what you're saying, incorporate a story. And I think that then directly translates to how you deliver a presentation, because, you know, a lot of people tell you to script, and I think that's awful advice. If you forget one word, it's going to throw you off. But instead, I use four bullet points: how you're going to open, the main point that you want to deliver, the story that you're going to tell alongside that, and how you're going to transition to the next point or close. They are the four bullet points that you need. So, you know, if you have 5 points, that's 20 bullet points rather than a full script. And so that makes it a little bit easier, but also brings the nano speech into where storytelling is powerful, that you can use that in everyday conversations and then also in your presentations too.
What you're talking about, I feel, is a perfect middle ground, because I've heard a lot of, like you said, maybe not super helpful advice that, okay, you should have a full script because then you can say everything perfectly. And on the flip side, don't prepare anything, just wing it. And I feel like that's right. Also very scary. So I like the middle ground. Just have some bullet points.
Absolutely. Like, I think you need something, at least when you're not at the stage where you're confident, you need something. And it's okay to have notes. What you don't want to be is reading off them. And like, I used to script my presentations when I first started overcoming my fear of public speaking. And what happened was there was one time I was recalling what I'd put in my script, and I forgot one word. It wasn't the plan to forget anything. And so it threw me off completely. It derailed the whole presentation. And all that I needed to do instead was have bullet points that I could talk around. So I knew what I was going to say, when I was going to say it, but it was okay that I didn't need to know it off by heart. And I think that's the piece that is often missed, because usually it is script or don't script. And you're going to be way more conversational and you're going to connect better with the audience if you don't have a script. And, you know, it might ease your mind too, because you don't have to spend hours and hours trying to remember the script, because all you need to know is the bullet points. So actually it makes your preparation easier too. So I think there are so many benefits in not scripting, yet that again is one of the worst pieces of advice that is out there, I think.
And tell us, Liam, would you say that there are any preferences in terms of storytelling between more positive stories, like you said, the cookies and the cinnamon, versus the more negative stories, the horrible traffic? Do you have any personal preferences or anything that you can recommend?
So I think it depends on what stage of your presentation you're in. It also depends on, you know, the context of your presentation and what you're delivering. So something that I know is powerful is you open with what I call an up story. So something that makes people feel good. So let's say, you know, I'm delivering a presentation on how to do public speaking effortlessly. So I might say, you know, I used to have a fear of public speaking, but I overcame that. And now I teach people how to speak stress-free. But then I want to put in there a down story where I show the audience that I truly understand the problem that they have. So then I might talk about that time that I mentioned earlier, where I'm sat in lecture theatre at university and my heart is racing, and showing the audience that you truly understand the problem that they face, because that captures their attention too. That helps them to feel connected to you as the speaker. So I think a good technique is to use the up story, followed by a down story, followed by a whole bunch of actionable items that are going to help people get from where they currently are to where they need to be. And I think that's often missed too, is that, you know, we can inspire through speaking and we can, you know, motivate people, but unless we actually give them the actionable items and how you get from A to B, it's not going to be that helpful in the grand scheme of their lives. And impact is something that's important. If you're obsessed with impact, a little bit like I am, then you're going to want to be providing people with the actionable items. So that's something that I think is important too.
Which is a wonderful point because I've heard countless motivational speeches that, okay, great, I'm pumped.
That's right.
And so
That's
that's a
it.
very,
What's
very good
next?
point. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, going to see a speaker is not going to change your life, but it might instigate the action that you need to take that could change your life. And I think that's the difference. And you know, we usually, you know, I talk about when you're closing off a presentation, use a call to action. And that's the difference. A call to action should be incredibly easy for somebody to remember what the next step is and incredibly clear on specifically what they need to do. That then sends them down that path. And I think you need to be very clear on what your call to action is before you go in to deliver your presentation. Now, that could be different depending on different environments. It might be that you're asking, you know, for some funding for a project that you're working on at work, or you know, you might just be presenting the work that you found and this is the outcome, and you're asking them for questions or their point of view on it. But being very specific in what am I asking of you, or what do I want you to do to take the next step to solve this problem that I've been helping you with, or to, you know, take action in the direction that is going to make a difference to you as an individual, or, you know, your business or your company or your family, whatever that might be.
And what would you say are some of these call to actions in just regular, let's say, friendly family conversations? Because in the business setting, like you said, okay, do you have any questions? Give me money. But in the more, let's say, friendly conversations, is it just maybe a follow-up question? Like what you were saying at the beginning, okay, I've been reading this book. What about you? Or what are some of the, let's say, more casual call to actions?
Yeah, I would suggest, generally speaking, in conversation, it's just finishing with a question. And I think as well, you know, when you're practicing the nano speech or using those conversations to improve your public speaking, it's a very clear point that you are handing over. So in your mind, it's like, okay, this was the start of that rep and this was the end of that rep. So it's helpful from that perspective too, so that later on, if you're reflecting on, you know, how those reps went, there's a very clear start and finish. So I think the question is the call to action. Although I wouldn't say maybe in a conversation you need one, but that's how I would think about it.
And do you have any favorite questions that you like to ask people? Any go-tos personally?
Again, depends on the context. I think using an open question as opposed to a closed question is important, because, you know, it opens up the possibilities of taking the conversation further. And like, I think that there is a really important thing of, you know, always asking open questions in situations where you don't know people that well, or you're in a new environment, because otherwise you're closing up the avenues that other people can go down. And when you ask good questions, people feel like you are a great conversationalist, because they were able to talk about lots of different things. So I think that the best thing to do, rather than giving, you know, some specific questions that you could ask, because the context really matters, I think just keep your questions open, and then, you know, take something that piques their curiosity. Or, you know, if someone mentions travel or a holiday and you love traveling, or you've just been on holiday, use that as a point of connection. So then you can then start building a bond based on, we both love travel. Let's go down that rabbit hole and we can truly connect here and we're going to be friends. Like, I think that's then how that plays out. So open questions followed by active listening to things that they are clearly passionate about, and finding that point of connection with them, so that beyond, you know, just public speaking, you are networking effectively, you are, you know, making friends, you're building relationships with people.
Certainly, certainly. And tell us, Liam, I'd love to come back a little bit to what you mentioned before with the more business professional side of public speaking and of communication in general. And I was wondering, with your experience in that, and for anybody listening that is also part of a corporation, perhaps even having their own business, and with your speaking experience, would you say that in those more professional business context, do you recommend also having that somewhat small talk, if we can think of it that way, the more, let's say, friendly kind of tone, friendly conversations, even within that business setting? Or do you prefer to keep it separate? Okay, this is a business meeting, like you said, a board meeting, whatever that might happen to be. Let's just focus on that. Or do you intermingle both?
I think you have to intermingle both, because ultimately you could be the greatest speaker in the world and, you know, have all of the techniques down and provide some great insights to people in a business meeting. But to truly be successful in business, you need people to like you as well. And so you need to both be an amazing speaker, and second of all, you need to be somebody that people resonate with. And finding those points of connections and some of those more conversational pieces is how you get people to like you. And I think if we go back to the stories, I think telling stories from everyday moments is also how you get people to like you, because, you know, it shows that you're somebody like them, and they want to feel like the speaker. They want to see themselves as, you know, somebody who could do that too. So I think both are absolutely necessary to, and sure, it doesn't need to be, you know, all the time, and there are situations where you just need the conversational side, or you just need the serious business mode side, but ultimately they are all things in the communication toolbox that you should pull out as and when you need them. And, you know, so developing both of those sides are really important.
Certainly. And like you said, showing them that you're human too, that you're a person.
That's right.
You also get stuck in traffic sometimes.
that's right. I think that's so important. And like something that I say to my team at work is, you know, I'm a person first and I'm an employee second. And I think that's a really important thing when you're a leader in a business. Because, you know, you got to feel like people have to feel like they can come to you with stuff that, you know, whether it's an improvement in things with to do with the business, or, you know, they just want to tell you about something that's going on for them right now. And I think that's a really important piece too, is that in business, you are a person first, because ultimately we're all people first. But, you know, if you take that business-minded approach, then the piece of, am I also likable, might be up for question. And I think somebody who can speak well and communicate well, and somebody that is well-liked, they go far. They go far in business. And I think that's a really important piece, you know, be a person first.
Perfect piece of advice. And for anybody listening that is curious to listen to more of your wisdom and to more of your words of advice, where can people find you? So you mentioned X, you mentioned LinkedIn. Where can people find your book?
So the book Effortless Public Speaking is available on Amazon and all other book retailers online. But you can find my whole portfolio at liamsandford.com. And, you know, there will be another book coming soon, and so some exciting things are coming up. So, you know, there is an email list that you can sign up to for a free weekly email. And as part of that, right now, you'll get a free download of the introduction to Effortless Public Speaking, with more freebies to come in that space too.
Oh, very exciting. Very exciting. And tell me, Liam, do you have any final words, anything that we didn't touch on that you would like to share with anybody listening?
I think the biggest piece really is if you feel like there is no way you can speak in front of anybody right now, find your most comfortable environment, whether that is a social audio, whether that's a Twitter space or X space, whether that is LinkedIn audio, whether that is somewhere where you can just sit there and nobody can see you. You can have your notes in front of you and you can just say, hello, this is my name, and it's nice to meet you. That can be your first public speaking rep. And I would really encourage you to get your first speaking rep in. And, even if it's with your family tonight over dinner, your first Nando speech, that's the thing that is going to kickstart the journey, because you'll realize that all of those fears you had, it's not that bad. The thought of public speaking is worse than the actual doing of it. And, in addition to that, I think that the final thing that's really important is you can be both nervous and confident at the same time. So if you have had a whole bunch of successful reps and you've done it before, but the next time you're nervous, that's okay. That just means you care about it. You can be nervous and confident, but channeling that energy to, I can do this, and this is my opportunity to show what I can do. That's the angle you need to go down. So that's the final piece that I think is worth sharing, Marty.
I would recommend to write that on a sticky note and just stick that everywhere around your house because that's wonderful. That's wonderful. And it makes a whole ton of sense. Like you said, it's not that, oh, okay, all of a sudden I don't need anything and I'm super confident. Maybe, sure. Maybe you still get, like you said, those butterflies. Maybe your heart still runs a little bit faster, but that doesn't
That's
mean that
right.
you're bad at it or anything like that. You just, like you said, care about it. I like that. I like that. Well, thank you very much for sharing, Liam, and thank you very, very much for your time and for sharing all of your wonderful wisdom with us today. And I am very, very much looking forward to staying in touch.
Absolutely. Thanks, Marty. This has been very enjoyable.
Hey, I'm glad to see you here. Let me know what you most enjoyed about this conversation, and if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. I'll see you in the next one. Do zobaczenia.